It's summit season after a hectic couple of days in Myanmar. Prime Minister Narendra Modi has reached Brisbane for the G20 summit. Global leaders are expected to discuss a range of issues from economic recovery to tax evasion. Bloomberg's Paul Allen joins us on the ground from Brisbane for the latest development. We'll also be joined by Gateway House Akshay Mathur on to discuss more on what India can expect. Paul, good having you on the show all the way from Brisbane. Tell me, what's expected at the summit?
Well, Harsha, it's all about economic development here at the G20 in Brisbane. It's really following on from the agreement that the finance ministers reached at their meeting in Sydney. This agreement or goal to raise global growth by 2 percentage points, adding a $2 trillion to the global economy. But of course, the danger with these summits is that it's one thing to talk about these things and to reach agreements. It's another thing entirely to get them implemented. And already we've heard from the OECD Secretary General today warning that reaching this growth target is going to be something of a challenge. Another thing that's crept onto the agenda just in the past 48 hours really is climate change. Controversially, that was initially left off, but it's gained some more impetus since China and the United States reached their agreement at APEC. The Australian Treasurer Joe Hockey confirming that yes, now climate change will be discussed, probably as part of a broader discussion about energy security. It's going to be pretty hard to ignore the climate here in Brisbane. The mercury is climbing. It's expected to hit 42 degrees Celsius here on Sunday, the final day of the summit. But for Narendra Modi, it's probably just going to feel like a nice summer's day in Delhi, right, Harsha?
You bet it is. But, you know, it's incredibly hot here in Mumbai as well. Paul, just one quick question. You know, do we know what's on Prime Minister Modi's itinerary? What key meetings are anticipated?
Well, the G20 is just the start for Prime Minister Modi. After he's here, he's going on a bit of a tour of the country. There are 450,000 expatriate Indians living in Australia, so he's expected to get something of a rock star welcome wherever he goes. There's going to be an open-air event in Sydney where he'll meet the Indian community. 20,000 people are expected to show up to that. He's also going to be visiting Melbourne, where he'll go to the famous cricket ground, the MCG, and he'll also head to Canberra, where he'll address the Parliament, which is an honour recorded to very few visiting dignitaries. And it's especially special that Narendra Modi is here. It is the first time an Indian Prime Minister has visited Australia since Rajiv Gandhi way back in 1986, Sasha.
Paul Allen, pleasure having you there. And Paul Allen is going to be getting us all the action from G20 in Brisbane and through Narendra Modi's tour in the next couple of days. Many thanks indeed for joining us with our on-ground report. We're going to get you comprehensive coverage of G20 in the next couple of days, but we're going to discuss that in detail. Akshay Mathur of Gateway House joins us on this conversation to tell us what's on the agenda. Akshay, you know, before I get to the G20, I want to talk to you about, you know, the position that US's position on WTO. Let's, in fact, tell you what the Commerce Minister had to say yesterday. It was a major victory at the WTO. The US has agreed to India's proposal on food security issues. This breakthrough ends a three-month-long stalemate. Mehak sat down with the Commerce Minister Nirmala Sitharaman. This is what she had to say.
If trade facilitation were to happen, as though as a single standalone piece, we will have to be waiting till 2017 to have a permanent solution for our requirement of public stockholding of grains, which actually we need to do because we need to feed our poor, at the same time procure grains from very small subsistence farmers. To find a permanent solution, to wait till 2017 is not going to be helpful at all. And also to have this peace clause last till 2017, and after that, just in case you don't get a permanent solution, automatically for it to mean that after 2017 you're going to be questioned every time you breach or every time you give any subsidy is unacceptable. Right. So we are very clear, and we went to the extent of repeatedly arguing that it is not trade distorting. At the same time, it is necessary to have, if I can say the word comfort, it is necessary to have the comfort that you are doing the right thing for your people, the right should be with you, and you cannot be dragged to a court because you're doing a sovereign duty. In other words, looking at a peace clause which is going to be longer than just 2017. You get a permanent solution tomorrow, we are willing to work with it, with the WTO. You're willing to give us a permanent solution by December this year, December next year, March next year, whenever it is, we are willing to work with you. But what if the solution is, permanent solution is eluding us?
Right.
We cannot have this Damocles sword over our head. Now that we have come to, you know, understanding, we honestly do believe that we will find some way that the General Council will treat both issues as compatible, both issues as seriously, equally important, and move forward.
Nirmala Sitharaman in conversation with Mehika Speaker. Akshay, you know, before we get to G20, this is an important one. I mean, India has been sort of going, you know, trying to clarify its stance in WTO for a while. Does this, in a sense, resolve the long-standing problem?
Well, it has sent multiple signals. Mm. The first one is that the government is serious about its negotiations, whether it is with the United States or with the WTO body, that it was not taking it lightly. And the channels that were set up between the two governments at the ministerial level or at the bureaucratic levels have been working very hard to find a solution. Mm. So that's a very important signal, especially from the new government. The second signal is that it should hopefully also now show India as an important and responsible trade participant at the multilateral level.
Sure.
Which means that now we can take it not only the WTO deals to a closure, but also start thinking about other trade deals. Mm. There's the Trans-Pacific trade agreement that is happening. There is the free trade agreement of the Asia-Pacific, which was just announced and also moving forward.
Sure.
And there's the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, which is the ASEAN and China and India-led trade agreements.
Sure.
So now we have to take this to our benefit to say we are an important player and can we participate and become part of some of these other global agreements and not get left out.
Sure. That's interesting and fairly significant. But let's talk about the job at hand today, which is G20. What's in it for India?
G20 is, as you know, made up of 20 of the largest economies in the world. So India is an important participant because of its size and its market and its position. It is also a time for India, and especially for Prime Minister Modi, to articulate some of its own concerns. So, of course, pulling investment into India will be on top of his agenda. And it works really well because that's what the agenda is for the other G20 leaders as well, infrastructure and investment in infrastructure. The second thing is, which actually Suresh Prabhu has articulated very well, is remittances is on our agenda, which is that, you know, we get close to $70 billion worth of remittances into other country. Transaction costs are very high. Even if it were to reduce, say, by 1%, that still means $700 million. So it's a good opportunity for India to articulate its concerns and participate on global economic governance.
If you look at the larger geopolitical conflict that's going on, Akshay, you know, Paul was mentioning the fact that the Russia-West conflict, the corporate tax avoidance crackdown, is that in a sense relevant to India at all? Does India have a dog to fight in this?
Well, the tax evasion treaties certainly will affect India, and India has been participant in trying to design it or co-create it. It's not easy to implement everything in the country. We are a democratic country.
Sure.
Courts have played a role and have taken a position on it. But at the same time, you know, there are 3,000 bilateral treaties in the world. So it is complicated for India also to operate in this global business environment. Every company now operates in multiple different jurisdictions. And tax, you know, the taxes, there's issue of taxes, the issue of transfer pricing. It is very difficult for a single country to take this on. So that's why G20 forum is important, because then all the countries can come together and decide how do we tackle this evolving scenario where a company's supply chain is spread across 20 to 30 different countries.
Sure. As Paul was mentioning, you know, Prime Minister Modi is also going to be traveling across Australia, a typical rock star like treatment, another Madison Square Garden kind of event that's, I'm told, likely to take place. What's in it for Indian companies? Those that have investments in Australia, those that look at joint ventures in Australia, what's in it for them?
Well, first of all, Prime Minister Modi is going, I think, after 25 years
or 28
years.
After Rajiv Gandhi that he mentioned.
Yeah, so that's an important signal in itself. Second, Australia has become an important partner for technology, and especially if you look at some of the industries that are closer to natural resources and such as mining, there's important things to share, you know, infrastructure technology, mining technology, and some of that has been articulated by the government. But beyond that, there's also high technology. We've only looked at Japan and the United States, but with Australia, we can do a lot, especially maritime technology. So there are many issues that Indian business can benefit from. And I think the starting point there would be something related to natural resources, technology, and best practices.
One final question. Does India, Australia have a role to play in the strategic sort of security issues of the region? Does it have a role to play at all?
It has a very important role. That role has manifested itself in two or three different ways. One is that we share the some of the issues and concerns of the South China Sea.
That's right.
And so India, Australia, Japan, and the United States have come together previously also to discuss issues in the South China Sea. We've also come together in forums where some kind of disaster relief has been required. But maritime security by itself is something that remains on the agenda. And if India and Australia can work together, especially with some of the other middle or other emerging powers, the littoral states, Indonesia, Philippines, Vietnam, other states, then I think it can lead to some very productive and important partnership so that, you know, our own interests in the region can be secured.